Hi! Today we want to make a bit of an excursion. Namely, we want to talk about the geometry of high-dimensional spaces. Consider a standard machine learning setup where you have certain objects you want to maybe classify. This could be images consisting of many pixels. So if you have a typical image, a couple of megapixels, your object lives in a space of a couple of thousand dimensions, right? Each pixel is represented by one coordinate in your space. Maybe you have several coordinates per pixel. They say red value, green value, blue value. So the object that you have lives in a very, very high dimensional space of maybe a thousand dimensions. Other scenarios, you want to classify, I don't know, customers into certain groups. And you describe the customers by their age, their gender, their shopping behavior, at which times do they visit your web pages, how much money do they typically spend, do they buy a lot or do they buy few things, and so on. So you have a long list of features by which you try to describe your customers. And you don't really know which of these features are really important or not, but sort of one of the standard approaches in machine learning is you throw all the features that you might simply have into your algorithm and hope that it makes something useful out of it. So the bottom line here is, in machine learning, typically our data does not live in R2 or R3 or something like that, but it lives in a very high dimensional space. And very high, from the point of geometry, already starts with maybe 20 or 50. But often in machine learning it goes until 1,000 or so, or even higher. And now what I want to show is that all the intuition we might have for low dimensional spaces, R2, R3, these are the spaces we operate with in our everyday life and also in mathematics. Whenever you draw an example, you draw a two-dimensional example, simply because you cannot draw a 50-dimensional example. This intuition often is very wrong in high dimensions. And this is something I want to show you today. I just want to give you a couple of facts. This is not a very deep lecture, but it's simply listing a couple of things and showing you how the world changes when you go to high dimensions. And it's great that my blinds go up again. I try to shade for the sun, but whenever it's windy outside, the blinds go up. I can't help it. I'm sorry. Okay, so the setup I want to consider is now the following. So assume, consider x1 to xd, which are random variables, they don't come from the same distribution, these are going to be the features of our data. And assume they are independent. And assume they have all mean 0, e of xi is 0, and say the variance of xi is 1. And we're going to stack all of them into one vector, x1 to xd. And this is going to be the object of interest. So I just write the object. So the object could be a customer described by features, it could be a molecule described by certain features, it could be an image in terms of pixels. So the idea is this is the object we have. And we assume for simplicity that we normalized all the features to have mean 0 and variance 1, as it is typical a standard approach in machine learning because you want to have your features to be commensurate with each other. Okay, and now we want to look at what are the properties of these types of vectors. So the first property I want to look at is the norms. And I call these now always a vector in this lecture. What I always mean is of high dimensional vectors. Norms of, maybe I write it explicitly, high dimensional vectors are concentrated. So what we have is, or what we are interested in is, and maybe I call this whole point X. Sorry, just to highlight it. So X is the name I give to this whole guy here. So maybe let's look at what actually we have. If we look at the norm, the expected norm of such a vector, I think I have the squared norm here. Then, I mean, you know what the norm is. This is just the sum of the xi squared. And because we have independence here, we can write this as sum of e of x I squared. And we know, because we assumed that we have normalized all our features, in fact, to have variance 1. So each of these expressions is 1. So we have n here, because we have a sum that goes, maybe I should write it once from 1 to, sorry, d. Good that I wrote it. So in this lecture, d is always the dimension. So the expected length of such a vector, if you randomly draw such a vector, would be d, which is sort of fine. We can think about that. But now we also have concentration inequalities. And I think the trick to look at here is, or what to observe here is, that this quantity we're looking at is a sum of many random variables. And essentially, you can apply Höfting or whatever kind of random variable might be appropriate to these types of sums, and you will find a concentration phenomenon. So by concentration inequality, so by, in this case, Bernstein inequality, one can prove that the probability that the norm minus square root n, square root d, I always need to be a bit careful because I took the notes from a different notation, square root d, the probability that this is larger than t decreases, as it typically does in a concentration inequality, minus ct squared. So this means that the norm of these vectors is highly concentrated. And now, what does it mean intuitively? The intuition is, if you're in a two-dimensional space, maybe, and you plot the norms, the norms are something that's not negative, at least. Say here is the mean of your norm, it looks a bit like this. So you have a very wide array of norms that could happen to your random variables. So if you randomly, say, sample a point from a unit normal distribution, then these are the kind of norms that you get. What happens in a d-dimensional distribution is that the norms are going to look like this. So essentially, here we have the square root d, here we have the square root 2. The norms are extremely concentrated. So whenever you draw two random vectors, they are going to have about the same norm. And there's another image I want to show you, and we're going to discuss it later. So if you draw, say, if x is from a two-dimensional normal distribution, I write identity 2. So this is means I draw a normal distribution with unit variance mean 0. So how does this sample look like? I mean, there are many points close to 0, and then there are lots of, and some further points out there, but there are going to be many points here. If you draw a sample from the uniform distribution in RD, it is going to look completely different. And we're going to see that later on in more detail. But this sample is going to essentially look like this. So all the points are going to sit on the surface, essentially very, very close to the surface of a sphere of radius. And the radius of the sphere is going to be square root d. So this is square root d. That's the norm of your points. And what this figure shows, I mean, of course, I can't plot it this way, so I would need to plot it in d dimensions. But what I want to say here is, the intuition for a normal distribution in two dimensions, we have lots of points, but they spread sort of evenly, it fades out at the end. If you're in a d-dimensional space and d is high, then all these points are going to sit on the surface. I'm going to discuss it later, and in particular, their norm is going to be all about square root of d. So there are, I mean, of course, you can also draw a point that sits somewhere in the sphere, but it only happens with very small probability. So on average, and not only on average, but even in concentration, most of the points are going to sit on the sphere surface and have norm d. This means if you compare two norms, and we're going to see that later, the comparison is something that is not going to be very meaningful. So this is, maybe I make little boxes around the statements I want to make. So norms are concentrated. And the next, maybe I just give it numbers. Norms are concentrated. So the next statement I want to make is, if you have two such vectors, they tend to be nearly orthogonal. Two random vectors are nearly orthogonal. Let's make a little box. Sorry, I forgot to mention, I don't want to prove these theorems. If you want, you can look that up. There are books on high dimensional probability, for example, the one by Virtanen. And you can read up these statements, including the proofs. I don't want to give you the proofs now, I simply want to give you the intuition. So whenever you have two random vectors, they tend to be nearly orthogonal. So what happens is, if you have x, which is x1 to xd, oh sorry, like this, nah, make it better, and you have y, also from a, also from a similar distribution of d dimensions, say they're even sampled from the same distributions, then if you look at this expected scalar product between these two vectors, x and y, it is going to be 1 over d. Okay, so this is the expected value. And you also will have concentration. But again, strong concentration. And I don't even want to write down what the concentration inequality means, but if you think again about what does it mean. So if you have, again, if you have a two-dimensional normal distribution, and you draw, so this is, say, our coordinate axis. You draw one point, and maybe you draw another point, and you draw a third point and a fourth point. And if you consider the angles, the scalar product is something that quantifies the angles. So if you consider the angle, for example, between this guy and this guy. I mean, this is not a 90 degree angle, this is far from being orthogonal. If you do this, ddim, and d is high, I mean, this is always what I mean, you have your coordinate system and millions of dimensions, you draw one, sorry, I want to have it in red, so you draw one guy, you draw the other guy, you look at the angle between these guys, and this is going to be a right angle up to a very tiny deviation. Of course, this figure here is misleading because what I plot here is just two dimensional. You need to imagine it lives here in a thousand dimensional space, and essentially the idea is in thousand dimensions you have so many different directions that the likelihood that two points are really sort of aligned in the same directions is very small. Because a point can have thousand different directions in which it goes, and as soon as points go into different directions, they tend to have the same length, according to sort of this figure we've seen here. So the scalar product really gives you the angle. Oh, sorry. Come on. And this angle turns out to be a right angle in the overwhelming majority of the cases. Which means that if you, for example, use a scalar product between vectors as a similarity function, you need to be really careful with what, about what you're doing, because in most of the cases it's going to be zero. Okay, I don't write down the concentration inequality, I just give you the fact. Maybe one thing I want to, one property I want to give you is, if you compute distances in high dimensional spaces. Distances in high dimensional spaces. And what I want to convey is they are dominated by noise. Are dominated by noise. Okay, and how can we try to see this? So now assume, I mean, I just want to give you a particular example. So assume we have a vector x that comes from a normal distribution Oh, I'm sorry. I think I can't even turn down the blind because it's not gonna work because it's windy. Anyways, you're not going to see me, but I guess you can still see the iPad, so I'm maybe not so important. So X comes from this normal distribution with mean mu 1 and variance sigma 1 squared, ID. So assume simply it is a normal distribution which has the same variance in all directions, independent components, and one mean is mu. And now I have a second one, Y, that also comes from a normal distribution with a mean mu 2, and the variance is sigma 2 squared, the identity matrix. And now what I want to do is I compute what is the expected value of X minus Y squared. Let's look at this. So this is, I mean, we know the norm, how this is defined. It's the sum from 1 to d, xi minus yi squared. And now I can essentially write this in terms of a variance expression. I'm sorry. Because the components are independent, I can write it in this way. Sum 1 to d. Variance of xi minus yi plus e xi minus yi squared. Okay, and now let's look at what this is. So this is d times, so here the variance term, the variance of xi minus yi, if these guys are independent, is just sigma 1 square plus sigma 2 square. Sigma 1 square plus sigma 2 square. And what is the expected distance here? This is simply mu 1 minus mu 2 square. And now, let's look at this expression. So this is something like signal plus noise. So this is essentially what we can call the signal. And this is what we can call the noise. And now the point is, in a two-dimensional case, what happens? So in the two-dimensional case, we have maybe here is mu 1, here is mu 2. And now I randomly draw points from x and from, so here is a point I draw from the first distribution, here's a point I draw from the second distribution. So essentially what I want to say, I mean, if you consider a clustering task or so, then your task would be, so you have points from each of these distributions and you want to sort of separate them. And then I wonder, in a two-dimensional case, if these normal distributions, at least the distance is reasonably large, then this works well. Because, so what is the distance between the blue guys? It is sort of the distance of the means plus a bit of noise. So, distance between x and y is essentially a distance between the means, mu 1 minus mu 2, plus a small bit of noise. And now what happens in the DDEM case? We have now essentially the so the signal is sort of the distance between, if we go back to the two-dimensional, this is the signal, that's the distance between the two means, and the rest is just noise, right? Now in the d-dimensional case, we have still the signal, but the noise component is multiplied by this factor d, and if d is high, then this is going to dominate very strongly the distance between these signals. Noise is going to be much, much larger than the signal. So whenever you sample two points, one from x, one point x from the first distribution, one point y from the second distribution, and you compute the distance might not be meaningful for the class membership. It just shows you noise. And this is really a big problem. And we can make it even worse. Consider a different example, even worse. If we now consider two normal distributions that do not even have the same variance, and this might happen very well in real world data, right? So assume we have, again, So that's essentially the same computation as the one we had before. So what we are then going to have is that if you look at the expected value of x minus x prime squared, as I mean, this is 2d sigma. Oh, sorry, I need to say I draw x and x prime from the first distribution mu 1 sigma 1 squared, and I draw y and y prime from the second distribution mu 2 sigma 2 squared. And the image I want you to have in mind is we have like one normal distribution, it has mean mu 1. We have one normal distribution which has mean mu 2. And now we draw a point x and a point x prime here, and a point y and a point y prime here. And for example, if you would like to make to solve a clustering task on such a data set, what you typically would expect is that the distances between the points that come from the same distribution are smaller than the distances between different distributions. So you would like to see that the x and x prime is close, y and y prime is close, but x and y are far from each other. And what I now want to show is that this does not happen. So we have now, so this here is the within class distance. And now consider the between, so the distance x minus y squared. So this is now mu 1 minus mu 2 squared plus d sigma 1 plus sigma 2. And for the y's, e of we have of course y minus y prime squared is 2d sigma 2 squared. And now assume for simplicity that say sigma 1 is smaller than sigma 2. So how should I do that? No. So assume, so if sigma 1 is smaller than sigma 2, or not even, doesn't even to be much smaller, but say it's smaller, then what do we have? So the distance of the axis between themselves is of the order d times sigma 1 squared, that's fine. The distance of the y's between themselves is of the order 2d sigma 2 squared, that's also fine. But now look at the mixed term. The distance between x and y is now in the order, so there's a bit of signal, but the signal doesn't play a big role because it's dominated by the noise term. And the noise term here, d sigma 1 plus sigma 2, sorry, now I mixed up the squares, so they need to be squares somewhere. I guess they're missing here. So if now sigma 2 is larger than sigma 1, then what we have is, then we have that sigma 1 squared plus sigma 2 squared is smaller than sigma 2 squared, right? I mean, okay, that's a very obvious consequence. But now this means, if we go back here, this is the order of magnitude we have within the class y. So this is within class distance in the second class. And this here is the between class distance, I mean all in expectation. And now what we observe is here the between class distance is smaller than the within class distance within class 2. Well, I just write within class 2. So if you have two points from different classes, x and y, their distance is still in expectation going to be smaller than the distance between two points of this class y. And so if I want to solve a clustering task and everything is concentrated, so these distances, they take place like this. It's not just the average and everything else is spread out very widely, but distances take place exactly in the way the expectations show. So we have a situation where the between class distances is essentially smaller than the within class distance of the larger class. And then clustering is going to fail. There's no way in this, how you could solve a clustering task if these kind of effects take place. What else? Projections. Projections are always going to look Gaussian. And I'm going to write this down. I just need to fix my number 4. Projections always look like Gaussians. So what we're going to have is now, consider again a normal distribution. So we have x, and say we have a uniform distribution on the unit sphere. Say it's a uniform distribution on the unit sphere. So the unit sphere is SD minus 1, and it has radius square root d. So the unit sphere is just the like if you have the ball of radius 1 in your space, the sphere is just the surface of this ball. And now the radius is not 1, but it is square root d. So this is essentially, if I draw points from a normal distribution with variance 1 in d dimensions, this is where all the points are going to sit. And now assume I project these points on a random vector, or even on a fixed vector. Now I project x on a fixed vector v. So the image I have is, I have here this unit sphere, so all the points are going to sit on the surface of the sphere, and then I have a vector and I'm going to project it. So maybe what I want to write here is, we project all these guys in one dimension, and then how does the distribution look like? It is going to look like a normal distribution. So the marginal, if you want the marginal distribution of this, if you take the sphere and you project it, the marginal distribution is going to look like a normal distribution. And if you want to have it in mathematical terms, the projection is just a scalar product. And if you normalize appropriately and so on, then this is going to converge in distribution to a normal distribution. And this holds no matter in which direction you project, because it holds for any fixed vector and the whole situation is symmetric anyway. So no matter in which direction you project, if you project on a one-dimensional space, the result is going to be a normal distribution. And now this is also something that is really, like if you think you have data in a high-dimensional space, your classes need to be really separate, like, and often what you do is you project them in a load, like say you want to apply a PCA or so, and project them in a low-dimensional space, and you hope that the classes would be separated after your projection. But here nothing is separated, so everything is going to sit on top of each other. Of course, I mean, we assume that the data comes from this spherical normal distribution, but now, from this uniform spherical distribution, but now you get the same if you sample it from a normal distribution. Maybe that's not yet so surprising. But now essentially the same is going to happen no matter which kind of distribution you're going to have. And like whenever you have normalized feature representations in a high dimensional space and you project in one direction, it is always going to look like a normal distribution. And you can try this. Simply try out a high dimensional data set, project it in one dimension, maybe not the dimension of one particular feature, but a random dimension, and then it is going to look like this. And by the way, this is maybe also, if you want to take it, this is an intuitive explanation for the central limit theorem, because essentially what is going on here, this projection is a sum of many independent random variables, and the outcome is going to be a normal distribution. So this is a geometric way of explaining why the central limit theorem holds or takes place, just as a side note. Now the next thing we want to say is the concentration on the surface. I've already mentioned that. So the volume is concentrated along the surface. And what do I mean by this? Simply consider, without any probability distribution, just pure geometry. Assume we have two balls. They are nested in each other, they have the same center, so I consider a ball around, say, so it is both in d dimensions, I write bd, around 0 with radius 1 minus epsilon. That's the inner ball. And then I have the outer ball, which is a ball of the dimensions around zero with radius one. So essentially what I want to say here is the distance between these balls is epsilon, between the distance in radius. Okay. And now let's look at the volume of the smaller ball compared to the larger ball. So the volume, what is the volume of the large ball minus the volume of the smaller ball? I drop the zero at the center. Maybe I should drop it here as well. So they have the same center, and one has radius 1 minus epsilon, and one has radius 1. Now, what is the difference in volume? So essentially, what I'm asking here is the volume of this blue ring. So this is what I'm asking here. And now it's easy to compute. We know the volume of a d-dimensional ball is given by, we need to take the radius to the power of d, which in the first case is 1, times the volume of the unit ball. Okay, in this case, I mean, I just write it very slowly. And in the other ball, we have the radius 1 minus epsilon to the power of d, volume of the unit ball. Okay? And now let's look at this. This is now 1 minus 1 minus epsilon to the power of d, the volume of the unit ball. And I'm not interested in this volume of the unit ball, this is just a constant, but I'm interested in this particular term here. And now what happens with this term? As d goes to infinity, this term is going to go to 1. Go to 1 as d goes to infinity. Because we have this power d, so 1 minus epsilon is a number that is strictly smaller than 1. We take it to the power of d, so this guy is going to go to 0, and then we're left with 1 minus 0 is 1. So this means the volume of this blue ring is going to be 1 in the limit, if we have many dimensions. But this means, like, if you think about what does it mean, it is like you have an orange, and the whole mass sits at the, when you peel the orange, nothing is left. So the whole volume of this unit ball that sits right at the surface. And inside, like even though you just take an epsilon strip, an epsilon shell of your ball, it contains nearly all the mass, and inside there's essentially nothing. I mean, it's the same as saying that all these norms are concentrated around a certain fixed value, but this is just a geometric argument. And so it also means that the smaller ball compared to the larger ball essentially contains no volume. So everything is contained very close to the surface. And this is in particular, I mean, I just want to mention this one more in particular. If you sample data from a normal distribution, so all the probability masses, so we make again our picture in the two-dimensional case, we are going to have something like, I mean, here are the data points, many of them are going to sit in the inside and some of them are going to sit to the outside. If I do this for a d-dimensional space, then what is going to happen is that all these points sit on the sphere, I mean, plus minus a tiny epsilon with very high probability. So there's nothing inside. Everything sits on the sphere. Whereas in two dimensions, nearly everything is inside and some sit on the sphere. Of course, again, I mean, this is just an illustration of what is going on to show that intuition is not always right. And maybe just one last example. Intuition is very often wrong. I just want to show you a little riddle. And this is just something that somebody has shown me in a lunch break once while he was trying to solve a problem, and he came up with this riddle. And I find it nice because it simply shows how, I mean, this is nothing deep, but how intuition always goes wrong if you're not careful in high dimension spaces. So consider a following situation in two-dimensional. We have, now I'm trying to draw this. We have a unit square, which has side lengths 2. So in both these directions I have 2. And now I put 4 circles in the square, just in the corners, and these circles have radius 1. I'm trying to draw it correctly. So they touch each other and they touch the sides. This didn't really work out so well, so let's try to redraw this one. Okay, so I mean we have, and this other one is also really not very well done. Let's try to do it once more. So it needs to touch whatever. Okay, so we have these 4 circles and they have radius 1. Or diameter 1, sorry. Okay, so we have a righted square of side length 2, circles of diameter 1. And now I want to look at the circle which sits right in the middle. So in the middle I now fit another circle such that it touches everybody else. And now, what is the radius? I write small circle in the middle. Now I want to compute the radius of the small circle. So what do we have? So what is the radius of the small circle? I mean, I know what the diagonal is in the square, right? In the two-dimensional case, the diagonal of a unit square is square root 2. Now I have a factor of 2 here because this thing has side lengths 2. So this is sort of the diameter, the diagonal of the square minus twice the diameter of the circles. Right, so and then I need to divide by 2 because of the 2 ends, 1/2. Because I have a piece here as well and here as well, and this is symmetric, so essentially these leftover pieces together with this one, they give me twice the diameter. And now if I write this out, this is just 1/2, and the diagonal of the square is 2. Square root 2, and the diameter of the circles is always 1. So this is square root of 2 minus 1. No. Okay, so this is the radius of this inner circle. So 0.4 or something like that. Square root of 2 is 1.4. Okay. And now let's do the same exercise in the d-dimensional. So again, we have that the outer circle, the black ones, has diameter 2. Now, what is the diameter of the cube? The diagonal diameter is going to be square root minus d, and this factor of 2. And so the not minus 1, that's already the result. Oops. And the inner circle will then have the size square root of d minus 1. And this is sort of surprising, right? If you look at this figure, so in this figure, the inner circle is much smaller than these outer circles. So they are really dominating, and then you have this tiny bit here. Now in this d-dimensional case, the outer circle still has diameter 2, but the inner circle all of a sudden has diameter of the order square root of d. And somehow it feels hard to imagine where should all this space come from, where this diameter d fits in, if all we have is around are these little circles of diameter 2. And maybe you can think about it, how this can happen. I have an explanation, but I'm not going to give it to you. So this is nothing that shows anything deep, but what it shows is that whenever you try to draw a two-dimensional picture of something that actually happens in a high-dimensional space, your two-dimensional picture is not going to be a good representation of your high-dimensional space. And so what I want to you to remember from this lecture is a couple of things. So machine learning very often happens in high dimensional spaces. Lots of features, lots of pixels, lots of whatever. So it is rare that we are in a low dimensional space. If you are in a high dimensional space and all the distances are not reliable, well, then something like a k-nearest neighbor classifier might be problematic. A clustering algorithm might be problematic if it's based on distances. If you look at k-nearest neighbor graphs, I mean, there are nice papers about how do k-nearest neighbor graphs behave in a high-dimensional space. They nearly behave like an Eder-Sweeney graph, which in a low-dimensional space is completely different. But in a high-dimensional space, a k-nearest neighbor graph, you can't really distinguish it from an Eder-Sweeney graph. So there's no structure whatsoever. The spatial structure all gets lost. And all these tools that come from intuitive geometric from geometric intuition in a low dimensional space are really problematic in a high dimensional space, so you really need to be careful. And this is a message that you need to know, because you're dealing with high dimensional spaces every single day if you work in machine learning. So whatever you believe is true in low dimensions, it might simply be aware of the fact that it might not be true in high dimensions, and that whatever you try and you observe something funny, the first thing you should consider is, well, is it maybe an artifact of high dimensional spaces?